This month on Seamaster Sailing, we bring sailing action in its many forms. Windsurfing, match racing, Olympic sailing, and record-breaking multi-hulls. And it's with multi-hulls that we begin, to Valencia, home of the 2007 America's Cup, for a brand new event, La Route des Princes. Valencia has been a major home of Spanish sailing, and this year hosts the start of a brand new event, La Route des Princes. Nine multi-hull speed machines assembled to race. Four multi-50s, four mod-70s, and a maxi-80. The teams are made up from top sailors from Spain, France, Switzerland, Great Britain, and Ireland. Ahead of them, 3,045 nautical miles in an ocean course that will take them from Valencia, out of the Mediterranean to the Portuguese capital, Lisbon, across the Bay of Biscay to Dublin, then past the famous Fastnet Rock to Plymouth, and finally, a sprint across the English Channel into Morlaix. Three racing classes, three slightly different courses to even up the race durations. Plus points won on daily inshore racing during stopovers, making up 25% of the scoring. And in the Mod 70 class, some famous and competitive racing names.
We want to finish first, to be on the right side of the boat at the finish. And what we want is to learn as fast as we can and to be among the top performance boat will be marvelous to feel confident in your speed, in your tactic, in your crew. That's what I want, basically. And if I have that, I will be happy. Yeah. Just coming from the Vendée Globe, very exciting with the new multi-hull, the Mod 70. So it's a new Virbac Paprec 70, and I'm just learning a little bit more multi-hull. I sell some multi-hull, but much smaller, and this is another dimension. The speed is much higher, so a little bit more stressful too, because we can capsize.
Jean-Pierre Dic is a proven short-handed monohull sailor. Three times winner of the Transat Jacques Vabre, winner of the Barcelona World Race, he recently completed the final miles of the Vendée Globe without a keel. French rival, skipper Sidney Gavinier of Oman Air, has respect for Dic and his talented crew.
Of course, Virbac Paprec has a little less experience, but it's a boat full of very good sailors, very experienced sailors, so we're feeling strong, but all the boats are strong.
Oman Sail have been producing sailing talent from the grassroots, and Oman Air Musandam have a new recruit.
His name is Ahmed Almamari. He was a F-18 sailor, very promising. I have to say, probably the most promising sailor I had on board. Still very young, very fresh.
Many of the teams have an inshore and offshore specialist to take part in this race. But for Sidney Gavinier, sailing with people he knows well is important, and has tempted back one of Britain's best offshore sailors, who famously said, enough was enough.
Well, I couldn't keep away, obviously. Funny enough, my connection with Sidney has gone back a long way. I did a round the world race with him many years ago, and I've always had a soft spot for him. He's been a good friend of mine, and I've admired his changes in his career in the last few years.
We have a nice atmosphere, nice confidence, and I hope, you know, the result would be at the level of our mood, I would say.
Spindrift Racing, helmed by Yann Guichard, and Sebastian Josse's group Edmond de Rothschild would also provide strong French competition in the Mod 70 class. While in the Multi 50 class, Erwan Larue's Fenêtre Cardinal was looking like a team to beat, winning the Transat Quebec Saint-Malo last year.
Win all the race. Route des Princes, Transat Jacques Vabre. Voilà. I won't win all the race for my partners on the team.
The first contest was an inshore race around Valencia, with the Mod 70s providing a powerful spectacle. Sebastian Josse's group Edmond de Rothschild was the most consistent team, managing four wins from six. close behind was Spindrift Racing, skippered by Xavier Reville, who was standing in for Guichard, who had a prior commitment to some Swiss lake sailing. The Multi-50s raced, but not for points. A chance to finalise training for the first of the offshore stages. The Route de France is about much more than sailing. It's taking a Grand Prix circuit to iconic cities and combining top-flight racing with shoreside entertainment. Thousands of people were dockside in Valencia, getting a sample of the delicious local food before waving off the competitors on their first stage to Lisbon.
Good, it's going to be a good race, I think. Very excited about it, and we'll see what's going to happen. It's going to be pretty interesting, I think. Yeah.
But the first leg is really important because it's a Mediterranean Sea and everything can happen. It's not a basic sailing because all the time the wind change, there is a big shift and the wind drop, so it will be hard, but I'm really confident with my team, and it's the first leg, so you have to put a good mark from Spindrift Racing.
The start was tense. Fast boats and competitive sailors all vying to take an opening advantage. The leg began with a quick inshore hop towards Benicarlo before heading on towards Lisbon, 805 nautical miles and around 3 days sailing away. Oman Air's Massandam's inshore racing problems were behind them. They blasted away, leaving the fleet playing catch-up. In the Multi-50s, Fenetra Cardinal took an early lead from Arkema. The Maxi 80, Prince de Bretagne, was one boat in a class of its own. But there was no guarantee the crew would outrun the competitive Mod 70s and Multi-50s. The 3,000 nautical mile course will be over in 1 month. Seamaster will be there every step of the way and will reveal the winners in next month's show. Hier, France, hosted the third round of the ISAF Sailing World Cup. And with the 2016 Olympic cycle gathering momentum, many of the London 2012 medalists are back from their post-games winter break to take the first steps on their roads to Rio. Seamaster was with Cypriot Pavlos Kontidis to see how life was different for him after winning his country's first Olympic medal.
Yeah, it was really amazing. A lot of people were waiting for me in the airport. Big celebrations, really big honor. Like an ambassador for my country in the sport. It was really amazing to see the Cypriots get to come to see me, to clap for me, to appreciate what I have done for the country. So, watching myself all the time on television. So it was really amazing. Everybody at least knows what is sailing boat, that's really amazing. And in Rio de Janeiro, I will try to add one more medal in my tally, and why not the gold to have some improvement.
Przemyslaw Myrański is Poland's windsurfing legend. London 2012 was his fourth Olympic Games, and he came away with a bronze medal.
I was always on the top. From Sydney to London, I didn't make any medals, so finally I got it in London. It was hard for me. It was perfect. I will try to compete also in Rio.
So Myrański is going for gold on his fifth attempt, while others like New Zealand duo Alex Maloney and Molly Meach are beginning their Olympic journey and are making a good start in the 49er FX.
We won the regatta, which was really cool. So happy about it. But it's been a close week of racing. Yeah, it's very trying.
Great Britain's Dylan Fletcher and Alan Sine sealed the deal in the men's skiff class, finishing with a 2-1-3 scoreline. Marit Baumeister christened her return back in the laser radial after winning silver in London 2012. She went straight back on the podium, winning gold.
Try to get back to my old level as soon as possible, and well, it worked out.
In the laser class, Australian Tom Burton overcame Croatian Tonci Stjepanović's early advantage to take gold. Robert Scheid tasted silver, bumping Stepanovic into bronze after making a comeback in the laser class after two Olympic cycles in the star. France's Charline Picon lost a substantial lead in the women's RSX after she was OCS in the first medal race. This put Great Britain's Bryony Shaw and Spain's Blanca Manchon into the driving seat. Shaw won the final race to seal her first 2013 World Cup gold. The men's RSX was a different story. Poland's Muranski came back to the class on form, winning both medal races to claim gold, a great start to his fifth Olympic campaign. Brazil's 470 duo, Fernanda Oliveira and Ana Barbacan's non-stop winter training was their secret to winning gold.
I know that some teams had a break after the Olympics, but we didn't. We just tried to start earlier, but we still have a lot of work. So we are happy of the three winnings and the three events, but we still have two events this year, the Europeans and the Worlds.
It was a similar story in the men's 470, but this time the dominant force of Australians Matthew Belcher and Will Ryan scooped up their fourth consecutive gold medal since teaming up. In the heavyweight Finn class, it was 1-2 for teams GBR, as it was a winner-takes-all decider. Andrew Mills got the better of Giles Scott to take gold. In the NACRA 17, Sweden's Tim Schuolo and Hannah Klinger won the mixed multi-hull discipline with stiff competition from France's Billy Besson and Marie Rieu. Next stop for the ISAF World Cup is Qingdao, China, and that's where we'll be going in part two with the Extreme Sailing Series. The Extreme Sailing Series set up for the third act of the 2013 World Tour in Qingdao, China, the venue of the 2008 Olympic sailing competition, and more recently, the scene of spectacular extreme sailing action. Two events sailed so far, two different winners. The Wave Muscat prevailed on home territory. The Swiss Alinghi team mastered the light airs of Singapore to win.
We found our rhythm last time. It's going to be hard to repeat that. It's a challenging fleet. There's so many good boats. Nobody's going to give you an inch whether you're in seventh or in first.
The Wave Muscat, though, they finished down the leaderboard in fifth.
In Singapore, we made a lot of mistakes. We weren't starting well. You know, it happens. It's sport, and you can't be on top of the game all the time. And
in Qingdao, Alinghi controlled the opening phase offshore before the fleet came in for the stadium racing. By day two, the Wave Muscat already needed to stop the Alinghi runaway.
3, 5 meters, 4 meters, 3 meters, 2 meters, 1 meter.
The Wave Muscat pulled out a big initial lead. But coming back upwind to the last mark, Alinghi were hauling back the deficit. But not quickly enough.
The Wave Muscat then showing how to jibe right in front of the VIP area. Executed very well. Jennifer just rolls briefly and then unfurls and is set.
The Wave Muscat held out and brought themselves back to within 1 point of Alinghi.
The Wave Muscat come down across the finish line. Will be their third win of the regatta so far, I think.
It was a good day for us today. Bit of a turnaround after the last event, and yesterday we did okay, but you know, we were making a lot of mistakes. Today was really good and the team's very happy. We sailed really well and now back into kind of our old groove a little bit and looking forward to the next 2 days.
Thick fog lifted over Fushan Bay as the sailors switched into racing mode in the late evening. Four races sailed, and the Wave Muscat won two, overhauling Alinghi's 14-race lead. But the Alinghi team had some work to do just to make it to the next start line.
Today we overthought it and got ourselves into some tricky predicaments, and you know, the results showed.
The Swiss team made it and chipped away at the Wave Muscat's slender overall lead, leaving just 4 points between them going into the double point decider.
Lee McMillan and Morgan Larson between the Wave and Alinghi. It's the Wave who have the upper hand just now, started to windward and will cross. In fact, Lee McMillan choosing to tack in front of Alinghi. We're looking at a match race immediately off the start line. And that's going to be the story of this race. The top two boats in the regatta fighting for the overall title.
At the first top mark, Alinghi played the trump card.
I think Alinghi are going to just go across on starboard, yes, and take it. Alinghi are going to, yes, there you go, classical move, starboard tack will forcing the Wave Muscat to tack.
The Alinghi team thought they had it in the bag. Forcing boats between them and the Wave was the perfect play. But the Wave crew showed why they're a dominant team and made a crucial jibe at the right time.
The Wave Muscat go for the early jibe, Alinghi jibe at the same time. It's absolutely all on here. The Alinghi just leading. They have SAP and Red Bull. Red Bull a little bit slow just now, coming into their final jibe. They're very, very close to the breakwater.
Wave Muscat picks up a bit of speed.
Indeed, and SAP are a little bit slow. Now, can the Wave Muscat get back here? They need to get round the bows of SAP. But they will be coming back on port jibe, so it's all on. I think they may just get there in terms of SAP. Red Bull accelerating for the left corner.
What a great move that was by Morgan Larson over there on the far side.
Absolutely, but this is about Alinghi getting through the line. The Wave have to get across the front of SAP. And ideally Red Bull. There's only one boat between them now.
The Wave Muscat pulled it off, gaining back crucial places on the last leg, enough to secure the regatta win. Alinghi were just 2 points behind in second. SAP Extreme Sailing managed their second podium in a row. The Alpari Match Racing Tour's German round was hosted on Lake Constance, where the teams had to sail through a mixture of conditions, from tricky light airs to 20-knot squalls. One team that has proved their racing skills through a wide variety of conditions is GAC Pindar, skippered by double tour winning helm Ian Williams.
Of course we wouldn't be happy unless we win another. That's not to say it'll be easy, but that's got to be our goal, and that's what we'll be trying to do.
In the two semi-finals, GAC Pindar came back from 2-1 down against Johnny Burnson's Stena sailing team to take the win, while 2009 Tour winner Adam Minoprio's team Alpari FX beat Mathieu Richard's Gefco match racing team. So the final was Williams' GAC Pindar versus Minoprio's Alpari FX.
Up a little. I don't see him.
A little lift
down. Conditions like that, you can't control everything. You've just got to do the best job you can. Sometimes it goes your way and sometimes it doesn't. And I think maybe we've got a little bit of luck in the semi-finals against Johnny. Just fabulous for GAC Pindar to come here to match race Germany and win the regatta.
In just 4 years, Oman has nurtured sailing talent that has made headlines internationally, and the Omani Sailor of the Year Awards showcased their achievements.
Your Highness, Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to a very special evening, because very soon we'll be recognising achievement with the Sailor of the Year Awards.
Winner of the Male Development Coach of the Year is Abdul Aziz Al-Shidi.
And the winner of the Rolls-Royce Female Development Coach of the Year is Nashwa Al-Kindi.
Youth Team of the Year, Marina Bandarova Optimist Team.
The Renaissance Services Male and Female Sailor of the Year.
Hussein Al-Jabri. And Sara Tobi.
I'm so happy. Actually, I'm so proud of myself. It was really a very hard year for me, and I suffer a lot with a lot of things. But finally, when I get this, I'm so proud. And after all of this, we're going to raise the Omani flag.
Coming up next month on Seamaster Sailing, we have the third round of the RC44 World Tour, the Korean stage of the World Match Race Tour, and the JP Morgan Round the Island Race. Not forgetting the roundup of La Route des Princes.